We've been doing a series on money. In all the years that I've been a pastor, we've only done two. In 15 years as the senior pastor of this church. And one of the reasons why we started doing it is because of the season that we're in. Inflation's high. Bills are high. But how many know that God has an economy that where he can bless you to the place where it doesn't matter how bad it is, you could still rise above it, amen? And the testimonies I've been getting, I've had more testimonies, and it's been absolutely amazing. Even from someone who's never even visited this church. Someone who's just online, they watch us online every week. And if I was to take a guess, I don't even think they've ever said a formal sinner's prayer. They've been watching us online. And they're tithing. They're giving like they don't. They're in Oregon. Come on, talk to me. And they're talking about how God's been blessing them. Come on. And I'm like, wow. So people watch us from all over. You never know, from all over the country. It's not just what's in here. People literally watch us from all over the country. But what this message is blessing people because it's about opening the doors for God to bless you in a time where it's kind of difficult. Amen. And so we were actually on the sixth sermon of the series. It's called The Revelation of Tithing. And you know what? Let's watch a little video and then I'll recap and we'll go into today's message. Let's watch this video.
And he said also unto his disciples, there was a certain rich man which had a steward. And the same was accused unto him that he had wasted his goods. And he called him and said unto him, how is it that I hear this of thee? Give an account of thy stewardship, for thou mayest be no longer steward. Then the steward said within himself, what shall I do? For my Lord taketh away from me the stewardship. I cannot dig. To beg, I am ashamed. I am resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. So he called every one of his lord's debtors unto him, and said unto the first, how much owest thou unto my lord? And he said, 100 measures of oil. And he said unto him, take thy bill, and sit down quickly, and write 50. Then said he to another, and how much owest thou? And he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said unto him, take thy bill, and write 80. And the Lord commended the unjust steward, because he had done wisely. For the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. And I say unto you, make to yourselves friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, that when ye fail, they may receive you into everlasting habitations. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. If therefore ye have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if ye have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. He cannot serve God and mammon.
Wow. That brings us to the title of today's message, Examining God's Principles of Finance, Part 2, Five Principles of Stewardship. Before I go into the heart of this message, that's a powerful, just listening to it. It's how many know it's good just to listen to the Lord's word even before I comment? Because if I miss anything, the Holy Spirit can tell you what you need to hear today. But let's just go over the principles that we've discovered so far. I mean, it's been a few weeks. In Nehemiah 12:44, we learned that there are three areas of giving to the church. They're called tithes, which is 10% of your gross income we give to God. And then there's an offering. It's any amount you give in the act of benevolence above your tithe. And then we have first fruits. That's whatever, in whatever area you make your money, you bring a first fruits offering. And the purpose is to produce likeness. It's a way of dedicating your income to God and saying, Lord, this is how much I would like to make. And if you want more details on that, you can go to past sermons. But why do we have these three forms of income? Because we find three reasons to pay tithes and offerings in the Bible. In Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 23, it tells us the reason why we pay our tithes is that it teaches us faithfulness. And again, I cannot understate how powerful a lesson this is, that a lot of people say they love God, but God says, show me your pocketbook. You know, there was a secular song that said, what have you done for me lately? Come on. And many women, if you can say you love a woman, but until you put a ring on it, come on. Right, which means there's some cost to that. And that's when you really, you know, that's when you show, I love that woman, amen. When you begin to actually, you put, and I'm talking to the men, but it goes for women too, that in other words, where you spend your money shows you what you really value. Reason number two, in according to 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 17 through 18, it provides an income for those who are truly called to full-time ministry. Reason number three, it covers the cost of the business of the house of the Lord, Nehemiah 11, 16. Like, for example, we've had two air conditioners go out. The reason why it's not hot in here, because we have to leave them on 24/7 until, because they can't even bring in a unit. Can you believe in Arizona, there's no units available for 11 weeks? And we're missing, we need two units. Well, how do you do that? Well, it doesn't just pop up. They're probably gonna be $15,000, $20,000 a piece. Well, who's responsible for that? How do we take care of that? Tithes and offering. How many know that the gospel is free, but to perform it is not? For me to preach it, oh, we could start a church in a park and meet every week, but I don't think you'll show up. Amen? So know this, that where's my money going? It goes SRP this week. Come on, talk to me. And we expose two lies. The first lie, and it's sad that a lot of people in the church are perpetuating this lie, is that tithing ended with the Old Testament. Hebrews chapter 7, verses 4 through 11 totally tells you that that is wrong. We still pay tithes in the New Testament. We forever will pay tithes because we have a priest. Come on, help me. After the order of who? Melchizedek. And some of you go, Melchizedek, who? Go watch the previous sermons and you'll understand where we're at. The second lie that we destroyed was that God wants you poor. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9 dispels that. And plus, you can't preach to the poor if you're poor. You can't give clothes to people if you don't have enough clothes up for yourself. You can't feed people if you're hungry. Come on. So the enemy would love to keep you poor, naked, and hungry so that you can't help others. And so there's no blessing in poverty. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, blessed are the poor. And people go, yes, it's in the Bible. In fact, it says, blessed are the poor. No, it says, blessed are the poor in spirit, not the poor in the pocketbook. Because that's a curse according to Deuteronomy 28. And where do we get our answer? King David, he was constantly saying, Lord, look upon me, for I'm poor and needy. And he says that as he's given a $4 billion offering to the house of the Lord. So poor has nothing to do with your finances. It's recognizing that without God, you can do nothing. Come on. Without God, I don't care how much money you have, you are poor. So you need to understand. See, a lot of people don't understand spiritual principles. They read, but they don't have a revelation. Okay? It's deeper than what you think. And then we learned five principles of resources in regards to vision. Principle one, resources are required to implement a vision. Think about this. You can't start a business, you can't start a ministry without resources. That's Deuteronomy 8:18. Principle number two, we're just recapping. How big your vision is limited to the supply of the vision. That's Ecclesiastes 10:19. In other words, how big your business is, how big anything you want to do, your wallet size will tell you how big it is. Principle number three, well, I want a bigger one. Well, then you need to understand these other principles, a bigger business, a bigger ministry. It's found in Haggai 2:8, God has unlimited resources. You have limited, but God has what? Unlimited. So the key is principle number four, which says that through Christ, God's resources become your resources. Come on, talk to me. That's Romans 8:17. And then you go, okay, how do I get those resources since he's up there and I'm down here? That's principle number five. Giving manifests God's resources. That's Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Amen? Every one of those took me 5 weeks to preach. And now let's go on to today. Five principles of stewardship. We watched it, but let's listen to Luke chapter 16, verse 8 through 13, and listen to what the Lord is saying. Because if you want to be operating with finances, listen, sometimes we're talking spiritual things about prayer. No, I'm talking about money today. If you want to operate in with finances, if you want to have resources, you need to pay attention to today's message because we're going straight from the mouth of Christ. Let's hear what he had to say about having money.
So the master commended the unjust steward because he had dealt shrewdly. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in their generation than the sons of light. And I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into an everlasting home. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon.
So now you've heard it twice, in video form, now audio form. And it's talking about being a steward, and he gives five principles if you want to be trusted with God's resources. What is a steward? The Greek word there is oikonomos. Say oikonomos. There's four definitions. Let me break them down. The first definition is it's the manager of a household or of household affairs. The second definition, it says it's a manager, a superintendent, whether freeborn, as was usually the case, a freedman or a slave to whom the head of the house or the proprietor has entrusted the management of his affairs, the care of receipts and expenditures, and the duty of dealing out the proper portion to every servant and even to the children not yet of age. The third definition is it's the manager of a farm or land estate or an overseer. And the final definition is a steward is the superintendent of the city's finances, the treasurer of a city or of a treasurer or quaestor of kings. In other words, here's what you need to understand. What is a steward? When you look at all the definitions, a steward is someone who doesn't own any resources. They only manage them and decide how they are to be used for the good of the owner. This is important to understand because we're told in the Bible that Christians, we don't own anything. We're just stewards of God's resources. This is mine, this is mine. Christians, we understand it's not yours. The Bible says the gold and silver is the Lord's. It says the earth and the fullness thereof. Everything here isn't yours. You're just a steward. Amen? Look at 1 Peter 4:10. And as every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Notice we are called stewards. That's why so many times when you read the Bible, all the apostles had this revelation, and they would start their book with Paul, a bondservant of the Lord. Peter, a bondservant. Because they understood that really, they are God's servants, and nothing is theirs. They're just the manager of these resources. Does that make sense? You need to realize that that's you, that you're just a manager of these resources. And you may have more resources than other people that you're managing, but listen, it's only here for a season. In other words, as Christians, we should understand that we don't own anything, but we are stewards or we're managers of God's resources for only a season. Look at Psalm 8:4. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou hast visited him? Let's go to verse 6. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands, and thou hast put all things under his feet. So notice, everything that is the Lord's, He's put it in our hands, but according to the scripture, we are just managers of these resources. He is the owner, amen? What do I mean by that? Well, in order to understand, you need to understand this, because in death, there's no U-Haul behind you when you die. Let's look at that picture. Right? You know, I mean, if you ever saw this, that person doesn't understand. Guess what? It's not going to make it to heaven. In fact, if anything, you don't have a U-Haul when you die. You have, show the next picture. The last haul. I call it the last haul. What are they doing? They're carrying your raggedy bones to bury them in the dirt somewhere. Not a U-Haul. It's a last haul. Say last haul. It's your last day. And why? You go, you look at Tutankhamun's grave, gold and all this stuff, and it's just sitting there. They brought it in there to take it to the afterlife, but it's been sitting there so long that we robbed it in the last century. Come on. Look at your neighbor and say, you can't take it with you. Say, that Lamborghini you got, you can't take it with you. Come on, go ahead, tell your neighbor, prophesy. Tell him that 10,000 square foot house you have, come on, go ahead, prophesy. You can't take it with you. Amen? In other words, it doesn't matter how big your car is, how many nice shoes you have. Guess what? Someone's going to take them when you're gone. And sad to say, if you're married, it might be a new man or a new woman wearing your clothes and spending your money that you spent, that you've raised. That's why I said, if anything ever happens to me, I'm going to haunt Bridget as a ghost. Come back. Boo, get out of here. That's mine. There's something wrong with your house, Bridget. Yeah, it's Pastor Joseph. He's walking in the, just ghosting people. Now, y'all know I'm joking, right? Okay. Once you're dead, you go with the Lord or the hell. Come on. I'll be with the Lord. I'll be too busy. We're not worrying about what's going on here. Amen. But while we're here, these are important things. So let's look at these five principles because they are powerful. Every one of them. And you know what? I love the way God is so down to earth. Sometimes, Christian, it's an old saying, we can be so heavenly minded we're of no earthly good. And these scriptures are so earthly minded. When you look at it, it's almost hard to believe in the Bible. Principle number one, learn principles of finance from successful people, whether they know Christ or not. That's what the Lord tells us. He says, you better go learn about money from somebody. And he says, it doesn't matter. In fact, he says, go find someone not saved because they know more than you. Yeah. What? Okay, Luke 16:8-9. For the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. You know what Jesus is admitting? That his people are sheep. Sheep don't know a lot. They just, come on. He says, and I say unto you, he says, because the children of this world are wiser than my children, he says, now I'm going to command you, make to yourselves friends of the mammon of the unrighteousness. You know what he's saying? You better go find yourself some rich friends, buddy, because you don't know a lot. We always think that the lost are deceived about money. No, it's usually the church people, because they think if they had more money, it would solve all their problems. The guy who already has already knows it hasn't solved his problems. He's got a lot of money, but he's been divorced 3 times. Come on. So one of the things Jesus says, he says, you better go find some friends who have money. He says, because when you fail, they'll take care of you. And, you know, even in this church, I mean, you know why this is so smart? I'm getting off my notes right now. Like, even in the situation we're in, we have to do multiple services because this doesn't fit us. You know, our congregation's a lot bigger than what we're in this building. And some people just watching like they don't want to be squished now. But even in this time of this economic harshness, and thank God people pay their tithes and offering. But one of the reasons why you don't see me sweating all the time is because I have a few people who have money. Come on, talk to me. Did you know that churches, they close 1,200 a month? You know why we don't? Because we're not hurting. Come on. There's a few people that I know that they don't even come to church and they'll give this big drop every, you know, and I go, thank God, we'll be okay. Come on. But these are people who've known me for years, and because they love me, they literally tithe there they don't even come here. Becky can tell you this. And again, why is that important? Jesus said, hey, when you fail, you're gonna need some people with some money. Come on, talk to me. Now, I would like to get 100 millionaires. That'd be even better. Come on, talk to me. But this principle is so important. When I started the church, I didn't have a dime to my name, and I'll never forget. The Lord, I go, Lord, how am I going to get built? I don't have a dime. I literally did not have a dime. And he says, I want you to go to the five richest people you know and ask them for an offering. And that's how we started the church. And I was given $70,000 within that first month. Right? That's how we launched the church. So, I mean, this principle is good. I need to start a business. I don't have no money. You better go find yourself some rich friends. I'm telling you right now. Don't wait. Leave now. No, I'm just teasing. Don't. In other words, what is Jesus saying? You can learn something from rich, ungodly people. Now, don't learn the Bible from them, but you can learn something about finances from them. And the scripture encourages us to have some rich friends. Why? Again, because he said the children of this world are, talking about unsaved people who have money, tend to know more, they're wiser than the children of light. Come on. In other words, you know what he's saying? Don't limit your financial education. We're not talking spiritual. See, this is where Jesus was down to earth. Don't limit your financial education to Christians. Only Christian sources. I only listen to Christian people. That's wonderful, but in finances, that might not be too smart. Because Jesus himself said, we're kind of dumb in finances. Oh, well, see, I'm offending people right now. There's some great Christian instructors on understanding money, like Financial Peace by Dave Ramsey. You have classic books like The Victory by John Avanzini. But what I'm trying to tell you is don't be afraid to explore books like Rich Dad, Poor Dad by Robert Kiyosaki, The Richest Man in Babylon by George C. Klassen, or The Millionaire Next Door by Thomas J. Stanley. Or here's another one. How about The Money Master, or Money, Master the Game by Tony Robbins? I have all these books. And you're saying, Pastor, well, but these aren't spiritually good. It's okay. I'm not reading these books for spiritual principles. I'm reading these books for financial principles. He says, you better go find some people who know something about money. Let me get off my notes again. Take Rich Dad, Poor Dad, Robert Kiyosaki. He wrote a book called The Seven New Rules of Making Money. It came out right before we started this church. Did you know that one principle from that book is why I'm still standing? And you're saying, what? Seriously. Because in that book, The Seven New Rules, I read the old book, and I don't remember six of them. I remember the number one rule. Because that number one, here it is. You want to know what it is? See, now you're getting a financial seminar here. He said the number one rule of money, right? I hope you get your pens out. Are you ready? Is you need to be able to receive money 24/7. You know how this has helped this church? So the moment we started the church, I told Pastor Bridget, and she developed a system. We have a high technical system that's never been breached that can receive money 24/7. Did you know our lowest day of offering is actually on Sunday? We'll come together tonight, and if it's a prayer night, I'm not kidding. You can ask Becky because she knows these things. It might be $5 to $10, right? Am I exaggerating? I have a bill coming up for $10,000. How am I going to pay that with a $10 offering on a Sunday night? Come on, talk to me. Because of this principle, people go online and give every day almost. So here, a secular principle business, I applied it to the church, and because we're not waiting for Sunday for a service, people get 24/7, it has tremendously helped this church not fall like many churches. What do you mean? I had seven friends of mine that started churches when we started ours 15 years ago. Only two of them are still around. And you know what I did? What do you think I did? I shared this with these pastors. Hey, the economy's changing. We're going digital. People don't have cash no more. We all need to go. I taught them the first. Now I'm going off on this, but I said, we need to understand the new rules of money. And when I shared it, did you know what? Five of them said, well, it costs money to do that. I go, I didn't tell them, but I go, you won't be standing in a few years. Yeah, it costs money to apply these principles. You can't be cheap and run a business or do things for God. If you're cheap, don't even start. Amen. Right. Let me go forward because I get stuck on this one. But do you understand what I'm trying to tell you? This is what Jesus said. You could go learn from people who have money. Come on. One of my millionaire financial mentors taught me, if you want to be rich, you might want to write this down, you have to have good understanding in three areas: taxes, real estate, and insurance. Why those three areas? Well, in understanding the tax system, it will teach you how to keep the money that you make. In understanding insurance, it will teach you how to protect the assets you possess are managed from being sued. Come on. In understanding in real estate will teach you what you should be investing your money in. Let me just think that again. Understanding real estate will help you understand what you should be putting your money in investing in. Let me give you an example. In 1974, Ray Kroc, the founder of McDonald's, he was asked to speak to the MBA class at University of Texas at Austin. After the lecture, he was impressed with the intentness of the students. He agreed to go for a few drinks with this small group. Once the whole group had their beers in hand, this is according to the story, Ray asked the students, "What business do you think I am in?" The students laughed until one yelled out, "Ray, who in the world doesn't know that you're in the hamburger business?" Ray met the answer with amusement and replied back, "That's what I thought you would say." He paused and then he said, "I'm not in the hamburger business. My business, ladies and gentlemen, is real estate." McDonald's is the top real estate owner in all the world. And again, I don't have time to express what I just told you there, but this is why you need to educate. You're looking at, you see a hamburger business, he sees real estate. I don't have time to break down all that means, but these are powerful statements. Jesus, go learn from the children of the world because they are wiser in regards to finances than you are. Principle number two. Jesus told us, plan big, but you need to start small. Where did he say that? Luke 16:10. "He that is faithful in that which is least or little will be faithful in that which is much." In other words, being faithful with the little will actually prepare you for the great. This is what he's saying. In other words, don't try to start here. See, a lot of people go, "Oh, I don't even want to start because I want to start here." You will never start. What you're seeing is a vision. That's where you're supposed to get there. But to get to that end vision, you have to start here. Most people don't understand that. You all, if you've been to Foundations, Radiant 101, you know what I want. If I was waiting for that to happen, we still wouldn't have started the church. You have to start here, be faithful, and build, and that vision that you have, that's at the end. Somebody else gets to inherit that. Come on. Pastor and author, Tommy Barnett, he had a book called "There's a Miracle in Your House." And he said, doing something great for God starts with what you have. In the book, he says, if you want to have a huge clothing ministry, start by taking the nice clothes out of your closet that you don't wear anymore and give it to a family in need. Start there. And now you have a clothing ministry. He says, if you want a large soup kitchen or a food ministry, start by taking the extra food you have in your kitchen cabinets, make a meal, and feed someone hungry next to you. Welcome to the food ministry. But I'm only feeding one person. That's where it starts. See, a lot of people, I don't want to get started till I can start this level. Listen, you have to start where you're at. We're not just talking ministry. We're talking also business. You might have to start in your out of your garage somewhere. You might have to start a line with a simple page. Come on. But if you're waiting for something big to happen or some big pie in the sky to happen, one of the things that annoys me is I've given a lot of prophecies about a transfer of wealth. And I'll tell you what annoys me when people tell me, well, when the blessing comes, I'm not waiting for the blessing. If you wait for the blessing, by the time you get it, you'll lose it all because you won't even know how to do it because you haven't learned how to be faithful with the little. Uh-oh. By the way, I have a prophetic insight. So I'm going to, all those who are about to be wealthy, I have a warning for you that's in regards to this. But that's, we're not prophetic insights right now. But it has to do with, if you're waiting for that, when you finally get it, you're going to lose it all because you have not prepared yourself by starting with what you have right now. Oh, Pastor, when the blessing comes, I'm going to start a radio ministry. Well, why don't you start something now at your home? Why don't you start a little YouTube channel? Come on. In Genesis chapter 14, Joseph had to practice his gift on the butler and the baker in jail before he went to Pharaoh. Y'all want to go straight to the president. And God says, oh no, you need to go to the butler and the baker. Well, I don't like them. They're not as popular. It don't matter. That's where you start. See, you got to practice your gift, because if you go before Pharaoh and it's off, it might be your head. So you need to understand this. We see this in the Bible, that before Joseph could go reign as second under Pharaoh, he first had to practice gift on the butler and the baker. See, don't despise where you're at right now, because God has you there because you're practicing on the butler and the baker. If you want to have enough money to retire, you need to invest a little money today, right now, in assets that appreciate over time. Well, I don't have enough money. You'll never have enough money. If you're making $100 a month, you should be investing a little, $1, $2 in something, because it's the principal. What do you mean? Okay, let me give you some assets that appreciate over time. Private real estate, rare art, farmland, rental real estate, precious metals. Did you notice three out of the five are what? Really goes back to the lesson I learned from my mentor. You need to learn three areas of knowledge. Zechariah 4:10. For who hath despised the day of small things? You know, I don't know why I'm getting this drop thought, so I'll say it. Pastor, you said real estate. I don't have no money. You know what's crazy? Because I've seen it and I've lived next to it. I've lived in South Phoenix for a long time. It's amazing how many of the people who come across the border, some legal, some illegal, they'll have like 10 of them live in one house, start a business, and within 10, 15 years, they have like five houses, every one of them, because they were willing to sacrifice a little to build something greater. I've seen that over and over. Now, let's not get into political argument, should they be or should not. I'm just telling you, that's what's been done, because they're practicing taking the little they have, maxing it together, and putting in an asset that it appreciates over time. For example, me, you know, I mean, I live in a nice house, and I'm not being facetious. It's a huge, beautiful house with a pool, but guess what? Y'all didn't buy it for me. Didn't come from the tithe and offerings from here. It actually came from the tithe and offerings from the last place I worked at. To be honest, because you know what I did? Paid that house. And so by the time when I started here, when about 4 years ago, I decided to get a new house. You know how I was able to do it? Because I had an appreciated asset. I had $300,000 that house that was above what I owed. Come on, talk to me. And because I paid over time, I was able to take that, put a big down payment on the house I'm in now, and also build a pool. Why? Because I had an appreciated asset, and now I really appreciate it. Come on. Oh, Joseph, that's once in a life. No, I did it before too. I had, you know, for me to be educated as Dr. Joseph Kern, it cost me a lot of money. And when I was done, I had $60,000 in loans. You know how I paid for that? When me and Bridget first got married, we bought this little home. And guess what? After about 15 years, we had a lot of equity. And I took $120,000 out. I paid off my loans. And we had $60,000 do some things. What am I talking about? Anybody can do that. And I'm at the lowest level. I'm just telling you. But again, notice, using real estate. But you got to be faithful with the little. And then what? Watch it grow. I want to go on, but I need to just continue. These principles are powerful. Amen? So what was principle number one? Go find some what? Come on, help me. Make sure you're paying attention. Go find some what? And what does that mean? Go learn from them. You might not be able to find them because they don't want to hang out with you. Well, go buy their books. Hey, isn't that true? I can't find no rich friend. Yeah, they don't want to hang out with you. You don't have no money. They don't want to golf with you because you complain about how much the lunch is. Oh, I want to say something so bad. You know, I'm not going to say it. You guys are so bad. I have to pay it when it's online. They go, that pastor is so rude, what he said. One back congregation, sad, sad. Go find some rich friends. Number two, what's the second one? Start what? Small. Right now. I don't care if you only make man, I got to confess. You know, when I got really sick 3 years ago now, I always say 2 years, but it's been almost three now. And it was scary. And be honest with you, you know, it was in God's hands whether I lived or stayed. That's not exaggerating. That's the truth. We didn't make a big deal back then because I'm a man of faith, right? And I'm here. But you know what was crazy when I was sitting there? What worried me the most? That I had worked at that time 13 years in this church, never took a salary. And if I would have passed away, my family would have been in trouble because I never took a salary. And I'll never forget that one of my friends, pastor friends, says, Joseph, if you would have just paid yourself $1,500 a month from the church, this was 3 years ago, and over, he started doing the multiple numbers. He's a math guy. He says, after 13 years, you'd have at least $500,000 in the bank because we forget the power of numbers. I said, what the heck? So let me tell you something. Guess what I started doing? You all do pay me a little something. $180, you guys have been investing for me in silver every month. Only $180, that's all I take. Guess what? After 4 years, it's looking like a pretty nice little stash. Now you're saying, why? Now I should be doing way more than that, but because there's something wrong with me, I like to give too much. But even I learned, wait a minute, I was wrong, because if something happened to me, my family would be in trouble. So now that's what you guys, publicly I'm telling you all, $180 a month, and they buy me a little silver. And man, now I'm kind of, once in a while, look at it, I go, yeah, that's pretty cool. It's not a lot, but guess what? Over 4 years, now it's becoming a stack. So what am I saying to you? If I can do it, and I'm cash poor, if you will, you can do it too. You just got to find a way and watch over time how what? Right? Does that help a little bit? Hopefully I wasn't sharing too much. I'll find out later after the service. Principle number three. Your financial commitment reveals your spiritual trustworthiness. Oh, that's what Jesus said. Look at Luke 16:11. If therefore you've been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust true riches? What is the Bible saying here? God says, if I can't trust you with money, how can I trust you with the true riches? Literally, that's what he said. In other words, if you don't tithe on what you make now, God's saying you're not going to tithe when you win the lottery or score a large inheritance. One day a man came up to his true story many years ago. He says, Pastor, pray that I win the $1 million lottery. I go, you want me to pray that you win a lottery? He goes, yes, because if I win that lottery, I'm going to give the church $100,000. So pray that I win it. Are you ready for my answer? I wasn't nice. I said, you're a liar. I said, because you won't give a dollar now when you have $10 in your pocket right now. You've never tithed. So what makes you think that you're going to give $100,000 when you have $1 million when you can't give a dollar when you have 10 now? You're lying to yourself and to God. It's weird how people think that somehow when they have more that they'll give all of a sudden. No, you're going to be even more tightwad. You're going to be even more stingier. You're going to be more greedier. You're going to be more lack of faith.
That's right.
You know, J.D. Rockefeller, he lived from 1839 to 1937. And you got to be careful what you read, because whenever you're Rockefeller, oh, Illuminati, you know what? You can't believe everything you read. Because you understand, the first Rockefeller was actually brought up in the church. He was a Christian. Now, I don't know if something happened since then, but in other words, you can't always throw everything out you learn, because you understand, the first one, he was actually a good one. He was the co-founder of the Standard Oil Company, which dominated the oil industry, and was the first great U.S. business trust. Rockefeller's wealth soared, and he became the world's richest man. He became the first billionaire. When he when he became the first billionaire almost over 100 years ago, he was controlling, according to my notes here, 90% of all the oil in the United States at his peak. And many people go, well, how did he become so wealthy? Well, let me give you a quote from his writings. I never would have been able to tithe, give 10% of the first $1 million I ever made if I had not tithed my first salary of $150 per week. One thing you find out, that he tithed his whole life to the church. And he says, had I not learned to tithe $1.50 my first beginning, I wouldn't be tithing the millions I'm doing now. It goes with that principle that if you can't be trusted with money, the Lord says, how can I trust you with true riches? And you go, well, what are true riches? Well, write them down. Your family, your wife, your children, God's anointing, the gifts of the Spirit. Do you know I know people who've been searching for the anointing and the gifts of the Spirit, and they don't realize some of them, it's because they're stingy with their money? And God says, how can I trust you with my anointing when I can't even trust you with the money in your pocketbook? How can I trust you with the word of knowledge when I can't even trust you with the knowledge you have in the word now? See, some of you will get this. God says, if I can't trust you with your money in regards to giving, how can I trust you with true riches? Because there's a direct correlation between your horizontal relationship with people and your vertical relationship with God. Over and over, Paul the Apostle constantly said, if you look at the husband and wife relationship, you'll understand your relationship with God. Where's that? Ephesians chapter 5, 31. For this cause shall man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and the two shall be one flesh. Look at verse 32. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Paul says, you think I'm talking about marriage? I'm talking about your relationship with God. Ooh. Okay, follow me here. In other words, your horizontal relationship with people that you're most intimate with will be a reflection of your relationship with God. What do you mean by that? How you treat God will be seen in your relationship with people. If you're cheap with your family, like you're cheap, your kids can never ask you for a dollar because you're not going to give it to them. There's a lot of people like that. Then you're going to be cheap with God in regards to tithes, offering, and first fruits. There's a direct correlation. If you miss church a lot, you're inconsistent. A lot of people, they're really inconsistent in church going. When you're married, it's going to show up in your marriage. You're going to be inconsistent in your date nights. Okay, come on. I'm a pastor. I've been doing this 30 years. People come to me with their marriages. They go, we never go out nowhere. He never takes nowhere. We have a date night and he always has an excuse. Guess what? I know you're telling the truth because he's like that in church too. It's getting so quiet in here. There's a direct correlation between your relationship with God. If you're cheap with God, you're going to be cheap with your family. You have a cheap spirit. You're tight. If you don't, watch this. If you don't come to church consistently, you're not going to be consistent with your family appointments, and you're going to be a lousy wife, a lousy husband. See, people don't understand that. When you're coming to church, and the Bible says don't miss it, it tells you don't miss, he's actually training you for reigning in your normal life. If you can't come to church 1 hour, come on, and sit and hear the word of God at Radiant, it's 2 hours, I'll give you that. Then how are you going to, what's going to be your reaction when you're working and your kid has a play? You're going to be sucky. Oh my God, I'm so busy. You're not going to tell the kid that, but that's the spirit you're going to carry. Come on. You don't get the relation. Oh my God, she's bugging me again. So are you ready for this? So if you have a horrible prayer life, your communication with God is not good. You're going to have a horrible communication with your spouse and your family. My husband, he just don't know how to talk to people. Yeah, he don't talk to God either. The more you learn to discipline yourself spiritually, the more it shows up in your horizontal relationships. Come on. See, no one wants to hear this principle. This is what Jesus said. If I can't trust you with money, then how can I trust you with true riches? Your family, your friends, your job. You're not going to do well because you don't understand the correlation. You think it's not that important. You don't think it's important to bring your kids to church. You don't think it's important that you come to church. And now the whole nation is jacked and immoral. I'll put this one on rerun and watch it 30 times. I'm talking to you. In other words, write this down. Make sure your spiritual statement is as strong as your financial statement. Look at Joshua 24:15. Joshua said, but as for me and my house, we're going to what? That should be your statement. Get up, lazy son. You need to get up. It's time for church. Honey, I love you, but get up. Don't be this little pushover that's afraid to bring correction to your spouse. Are you that weak, man? Come on. I'm talking to someone right here. Oh, she just don't want... Really? You know, you're always beating that chest. Come on, be the man that you're supposed to be. And why don't you do it for God? Get those children up. Get your wife up. Bring them to church. Teach them how to pray. Teach them how to give. Teach them how to read the Word of God. I know what I'm saying ain't popular right now, but I'm trying to tell you, you want to be trusted with money? God says, I can't trust you with money until you learn these things. There's a correlation. So the better you get at this, the more God says, I can trust you with that. If you're hearing the audio, I'm talking about moolah, show me the money. Remember, I'm not talking about spiritual stuff. I'm talking about money today. Monet. Someone say Monet, Monet. Principle number four. Promotion comes by being faithful with others' resources. Look at Luke 16:12. And if you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? In other words, God will promote you when you've proven to be trustworthy in another man's inheritance. Just a drive-by, going back to, see, this is why you need to read. You know the Rockefellers? They had the largest oil company. You know how they trained their sons to take over? When they became 18, they put them on the field with the oil workers and they said, I'll come get you when you're ready. And after a month, a year, they learned how to work, they learned to do, that's when they now had the office job because they understood the business from the groundwork. See, that's why I said, go learn from these people. You know, you can make fun of, and I'm gonna go ahead and say it anyways, you can make fun of Donald Trump all you want, but all his kids run multi-billion dollar industries. Why? Go read his book. Before it was unpopular, I read The Art of the Deal. And now he'd make his kids the same thing, do what the Rockefellers did with their kids. Again, you may not like them, but at least admire, they're running multi-billion, because a lot of people have wealthy kids, and all they do is do porn somewhere and a website to increase money. They do nothing valuable. Come on, you know this is true. You know, and I won't name them, but I almost did, okay? When I lived in an apartment, I remember my wife one day was, Joseph, why are you making it so, I mean, I would make it clean. I mean, so clean that most people don't do this with apartments. And she asked me, Joseph, I'll never forget this. She goes, why are you doing this? And I asked her, I go, if God can't trust me with another man's, I'll never get a house. I live that. You know, when I was 26 years old, I started working for Pastor Lee Pace at the River of Life. The church was a mega church. And I'll never forget, after he heard me from 1 year preaching, he offered me to have a big old building. It was huge, larger than the building they had at that time. He was gonna cut off, he was gonna give 300 people and launch me. I wasn't married yet. And all I had to do was say yes. And I said no. And he couldn't believe it. He says, no one would ever turn that down, Joseph. And you know why I turned that down? Because I said, I wanna be faithful in your house first. Because if you can't be, now he thought I was worthy, but in my heart, I didn't feel like I was yet. You gotta know that. You gotta be first faithful. And because I labored 14 years for him and then 7 years for another man, guess what? By the time I was 39, I was ready. Even though I'd been offered, by the way, I'd been offered many times before that, not just that one time. But I knew, I understood the principle that until you can be trusted with another man's, how can God trust you with what you want? So this principle works in everything. I don't care what business you want, what kind of ministry. You first have to be seen. How are you going to treat the resources of somebody else? Watch. When you get this revelation, it's going to change the way you act at work. You're not going to be trying to cheat the time cards. Come on. You're not going to be like, you know, you're supposed to have a certain amount of calls, but you're cheating in that. Come on. You're not going to be doing all this talking when you should be stalking. Come on. Because you have the revelation. If this was my business, that's not how I would do it. When you have the revelation of being trusted with somebody else's resources so that God can trust you with your own, it will change how you deal with people, how you deal with elders. You ain't going to be all smart with older people because you realize one day you're going to be older. You're not going to be rude and dismissal of little kids because you realize, come on, that if you want your own kids, you got to learn how to treat somebody else's kids right. If you're a step parent and you don't know how to be nice to that kid, God will never trust you with your own. Come on. I tell people, seriously, when they say I can't have a child, I say go find someone's child and spoil it in a good way. Hang out with it, play with it, do things, because if you God can trust you, come on, with somebody else's, then you can actually produce a miracle where God says, you know what? I'm going to give them their own. It will change the way you borrow things. Some of you borrow a book you still haven't returned in 10 years. Come on, I know that's you. Can I borrow? You know, you never return nothing. And God says, you know what? I ain't going to give you nothing because you borrow everybody else's stuff. Come on. It will cause you to volunteer for a community. You know, why as a pastor do we go feed the starving children? We join that thing. Why? Because I want to do that myself. I don't have the means to do that, but that's not going to stop me from affecting the world today by volunteering and getting the church to volunteer, giving you a vision that this is what I'd like to do, but at this day, I don't have the resources, so let's see what happens if we help somebody else. See, I practice this all the time because God says, how you treat another man's resources, he goes, that's how, then once you've earned my trustworthiness, now I can trust you with your own. That's basically what that means. He said it this way, if you have not been faithful in which is another man's, who shall give you that which is yours? Biblical examples, Abraham took care of his nephew Lot, think of this, before he was given his own son Isaac. Moses had to be faithful 40 years with Jethro's flock. He literally was the shepherd of Jethro's flock before he allowed him to be the shepherd of Israel. David, King David, was King Saul's armor bearer before he became the king. Paul and Barnabas were first preachers and teachers, prophets of a local congregation before they became the apostles to the world. You see this from Genesis to Revelation, that before God promoted anyone, he first gave them gave them the opportunity to see how they would serve somebody else. So whatever your dream is, your vision is, I don't care if it's an animation job. Go find someone who already has it and volunteer. Make that thing more honorable and see what God does for you. Principle number 5. Putting God first will keep you from falling into the traps that come with money and power. Luke 16:13. We cannot serve God and mammon. Let me put it this way. What you've been seeking is what you truly serve, and what you truly serve is what you've been seeking. In other words, your priorities will reveal what is of the true importance in your life. Where you're at today is a byproduct of your time spent, your energy, and money. Let me give you a few questions to help you understand this principle. What has been your priorities? I'm asking. What is the source of your affection? What do you spend your money on? What places have you been frequenting? What gives you the most joy? Why am I saying this? Because if you put God first, when you get the wealth, it will keep you from falling into the traps of wealth. Because what you seek reveals your true love. Notice Proverbs 8:17. I love them that love me, and those that seek me early shall find me. The scripture basically says here, if you love God, you're going to seek him. But many of the things that we spend our time on are shallow, fleeting, and are of no future consequence. How many times do you really have to watch those videos until 3 a.m? You're wasting a lot of time. They give a short-term bliss, but with the feeling of emptiness later. The scripture says that the love of money is the what? Root of all evil. Now, I know my time has come to a close, but I need to give you this scripture. Let's hear this scripture. It's 1 Timothy 6:5-10. Let's hear it.
Useless wranglings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a means of gain. From such, withdraw yourself. Now, godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing, with these we shall be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows.
Notice the root of all evil isn't money, it's the what? Love of money. And it says that when you're rich, it brings temptations, it brings snares, that means traps, it brings foolish and hurtful lusts, it brings destruction, it brings perdition, it means ruin or spiritual demise, it causes some to err from the faith, and it also will cause some to exhibit behaviors that cause themselves to shoot themselves in the foot. It says literally, pierce themselves with sorrows. You know, you see some people, and they're going through craziness. Well, no one did it to them, they did it to themselves. When you're on crack, come on, and you're shopping around and doing whores all day, guess what? You're doing that to yourself. In other words, listen to this. Write it down. The more money you have, the more lustful temptations you will encounter. Let me say it again. The more money you have, the more lustful temptations you will encounter. You know why some people don't get into trouble? Because they can't afford it. What am I trying to say here? The lack of money in some people's life have kept them from hell. Some of you, God will never allow you to be rich because the moment you have money, you're going to go to hell. I'm trying to tell you, not everyone's called to be extremely rich because it comes with great temptations. And some of you should be thankful that you have just enough, because a little bit more, you won't even be in church anymore. Some of the prophecies I've given, I can't wait to see the week after many of them come to pass. It would be interesting to see who understands what I just said here. Get ready. Many say, but, you know, becoming rich makes people bad or immoral. Wrong. Write this down. The more money you have will only reveal to a greater degree the moral compass you possess on the inside. The more money you have only tells you what was already on the inside. What do I mean? If you're evil, you will become even more self-destructive when you have more money. If you are righteous, you will become even a bigger blessing with more money. Come on. I hope you understand what I'm saying here. Money is not the root of evil. It's the love of the money. It's the corruption within. And some of you have a lot of corruption you don't even realize. And God says, you know, I'm not blessing you because I'm actually keeping you from hell. Last scripture, Matthew 6:33. But seek ye first, come on, help me, the kingdom of God and his what? And say what? Some of these things? One or two things? All these things shall what? Look up here. When you read the context, which is one of the seven rules of interpretation, he talked about money, and then he talked about clothing, and then he talked about food. So the context of this scripture, talking about money, clothing. Remember he said even the birds, you know, they don't work, but God, you know, makes sure they eat. He says the flowers, they don't go to the mall. Now, and I'm giving you modern interpretation. He says they don't go to the mall, but they look so beautiful. They're beautifully arrayed. God clothes them. And if he clothes them, why do you think he's not going to clothe you? If he sees every bird that falls to the ground, the sparrow, we know there's, some of you know the song, right? Then, so the context of this, it's all about money, clothing, and food. And what does he say? But seek ye first the kingdom of God in all these things. What are all these things? Money, clothing, and food will be added unto you. So what am I trying to say? It is possible to have all these things if your heart is right. Amen. So your number one priority to make sure should be what? That your what? Heart is right. Because you go, no, I'm just going to let God make me poor so I don't go to hell. No, that's not God's best. The best is to have a right heart, have a change so that God can bless you with these things so that you can be a blessing to the world. Let's stand in the house of the Lord.